Shalom, welcome back to Claim Your Inheritance. I'm your host, Nazi Divine, Amiel Oz Yasher Al. I am the Crown Prince of Israel, the President Pro Tem of New Jerusalem until the real president wins elections. I am the Acting Governor of North Carolina for Brim Nation until they free my brother, Major Brim. I want to encourage everyone to get their ID. It's the only international Israelite messianic ID in the world. It's a badge of honor. You got to have it. I want to encourage you to join the military. All the men 20 and older will be in the military. I want to give all praises to the Heavenly Father, the Wonderful Son, and the Holy Spirit. I'll be joined by my co-host, Amaziah Yahweh. Actually, he'll be the host for tonight. I'm going to listen in as he breaks down the Hebrew. And it's important for us to learn Hebrew. You know, I don't know it. So what I do is refer to the blue letter, and the blue letter is not the foremost expert, but it does help a lot to just look up the definition of the word, you know, as you're reading, or something that you are not too familiar with. You just look it up in the blue letter and it, bam, it just pops right on up. But if you knew how to read Hebrew yourself, then, you know, you wouldn't need the dictionary. So it just makes the learning easier. You can fully understand the Bible without the dictionary as well. Okay. So I'm going to finish setting this up here. And wait for our co-host to join us, our host for this evening. He's going to be hosting. I'm going to be listening. Okay. Make sure everyone knows about the event. And we'll be getting started here just momentarily. Bear with me. Got started a little late, letting everyone know that the show was starting here. Okay, so he may go over the app that we have now. We developed the app to make voting much more convenient. You don't have to leave your home. You can sit home in your pajama jams and nominate your favorite leader. I already know you're going to nominate your school leader. And, you know, The people who aren't in schools are going to be nominating various people as well. And I encourage you yourself to run for varying offices. You know what I'm saying? We need lots of secretaries and treasurers and all types of other positions. So there's plenty of every single position needs to be filled. So there's plenty of room for everybody. So you know what I'm saying? I encourage all of you to run for office and to also nominate your favorite leader. Okay, my co-host is now in, so I'm going to hand the whole show over to him. And if he has any questions for me, he can just let me know.
Shalom, shalom. I want to say all praise to the Most High and Rakata to the family out there. It's another episode of Claim Your Inheritance. So I know I missed a little bit of what you said right there at the beginning because I didn't have the link yet, but you're talking about basically the elections in the app and whatnot. Yo, Devi, you can hear me? Devi. Devi. Hold on, yeah. I think he must have got up and left. What the hell? All right, we're going to go ahead and talk about these elections. The brother said he had a did a video on it earlier.
There was some type of technical difficulties going on right there.
Okay, so he got where he went to.
I just want to let everybody know, I want to announce that Claim Your Inheritance on YouTube got a facelift. So, you know, it's not good to mix business with pleasure, right? So, you know, I own a little handyman service, and my YouTube and all kinds of other things are strictly branded on my business. So, but since I use my YouTube strictly for ministry, then it is my pleasure to serve the Father, you know what I'm saying? So I can't mix business with pleasure. So I took all the branding off of my business and just branded it strictly based on the work that we do here. So I think the technical difficulties are gone. I'm gonna be I'm just gonna mute my mic and let you take over.
Yeah, so I was gonna see if you wanted me to get into that video a little bit.
Yeah, whatever you want to do, you the host tonight. I'm just be listening in. I know you want to talk about Hebrew a little bit, so.
Kind of, yeah. Yeah. Hebrew math. Brother EC.
Yeah, if you want to play the video, you can too. And I'm just gonna be promoting while you talk.
Come on, I'm gonna do that. I need to get my HDMI cable right quick. Bring it up here.
All right.
All right. Let's see. What did you think of the show last night? Yeah. Devon.
Which one?
The Black Star show last night.
I didn't see it. I don't think.
Yeah, you did. You was there when we were talking about the Black Woman God and whatnot.
Oh, you talking about Cookie? Yeah, Cookie show.
Yeah, man.
That was interesting. I didn't appreciate her position because, you know, she didn't realize that all humans are God. So, you know, but her intentions to saying that God is ambiguous and ill-defined for the sleepwalking masses, they don't realize that means being holy and, you know what I mean? So it's best to say something to the nature of the Black woman is divine or the Black woman is holy. So I like that, how she put it into those terms. You know what I'm saying? Yeah.
I kind of wanted to bring up a little bit with that as well. as when we compare it to the Hebrew math, they kind of break down the words of man and woman, or the husband and wife, which the husband is Ish and the wife is Aisha. Let's see. First, I'm gonna play this video right quick though. It's breaking news about elections.
Yeah.
Hello, welcome to
Claim Your Inheritance.
Can you
hear it? Yeah. Okay. The Crown Prince of Israel. I'm also the President of the New Jerusalem and the Acting Governor of Brim Nation from North Carolina. Here's my brother, Major Brim. Tonight. We know what the Bible says to do, and we do it to the best of our ability. On this series, Claim Your Inheritance, the World's Holiest Government, we are certain that elections are necessary to form a nation. Hosea 1:11 says that we're going to appoint a leader over us. The ultimate leader, of course, is Heavenly Father. However, the Heavenly Father uses people to get things done on earth for us to become more prosperous and to help us to disintegrate from this satanic system of oppression that we're currently facing. So, I just want to share some breaking news about the elections of February 2017. And I want to encourage everyone to get your ID, the only international messianic ID in the world. I also want to encourage you to join our military. That is mandatory as a citizen of England. Okay. Here we have an app that in June.
What? Probably, I don't know. So, you shine a bag, you know it's hot, which way they're going to turn it.
I'm not very tech savvy, so, I could use your help if you are tech genius. So I'm just developing this app here, and it's pretty simple. You know, it just has just a couple of pages in it, and click through, you'll be able to register to vote, and you'll also be able to. Well, I'll show you the functionality of it when we get to one here. So we have the social media pages. We got the Claim Your Inheritance social group on Facebook, and we also have Claim Your Inheritance Twitter page. New Jew Vote. It's spelled just like this: NUJU Vote. That's on Twitter, on at New Jew Vote. So you can tweet your name, and you'll be registered to vote that way.
Okay, we'll get back into that a little more here in a minute as well. I want to say shalom to the Queen KK. How you doing today?
KK, the New Yorker.
You hear me, Queen?
Hello?
Hey, shalom.
Shalom, what's up?
Not too much. It's, we were trying to go over this Hebrew math, this new form of math the brother introduced to the brother Isu Shatifa. I'm going to pull his YouTube channel in a minute and show you some stuff right quick. I wanted to actually use it to break down some of the terms we were talking about yesterday with is the black woman God. Some things I find interesting when you break it down with the Hebrew math. Let's see it.
What's up? What's up, KK?
Hey, what's up?
What's up?
Who's this girl? Clinton. Who is this?
This is George Clinton.
This is George
Clinton.
I don't want to mess up your name. Amaziah?
No, George Clinton.
What in the world?
Talking to you. I was the first one talking to you.
Wait, how you say your name?
Amaziah.
See, I had said your name earlier. I said it right. I said it wrong this time.
You don't know how to read.
What?
Illiterate.
That has nothing to do with that.
You sure?
Yes.
Well, he's going to teach you the Hebrew tonight anyway. So. By the time this class is over, you'll be an expert.
An expert?
Don't take but one time for Amaziah to tell you, then you got it.
I mean, I don't even really know much about that stuff.
I'm going to say, you're going to get to it right here.
Hey, listen.
I don't really know.
You told me to be patient, though. And look at my thing.
You smell good.
Thank you. But look at my thing.
What about this pizza?
Right now. Keep your mind focused right now.
I'm hungry. I'm so hungry.
My avatar told me last night.
Yes. Thank you.
You ain't got the white man on there no more. Y'all can see my screen?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah. So basically,
that's Hebrew, right?
Yeah, this is something I thought was interesting, right? When you okay, so right here, the first one is of course it starts with
Kate.
What? Oh, it changed. It worked.
Okay, thank you.
The first.
It took time, right?
First from left to right, right?
Forever.
So you got the first symbol you got is the olive. And you got the bait, gimel, dalet, hey. And then the wa or the wu, zion, ket, yod,
I might pick it off, give it to dogs,
kaf, lamed, down here. Starting here, you got the lamed, the mem, the nun, the samik, the ayin, okay, the pei, sadi, kaf, resh. Shin and then a top.
I saw. I don't know nothing about that.
Basically, that's what I'm showing here, right?
You know, I speak Arabic too. Now look.
you read the Medinetta?
Yeah, I read Medinetta.
Okay. You need to get on here and teach us that one day.
All right, so this is what I found interesting, right? When you split these up in this formation, right? You end up with the name of Amashiach.
No wonder.
Okay.
Hello?
So, yeah.
Wait, sorry to cut in. What other stuff did you want to add to the whole Bash is God thing?
That's what I'm getting to.
Okay.
Yeah. That's what I'm gonna show y'all here in a second. Some of the different the breakdowns on the word, right? So basically with the Hebrew, what you have is a system of characters that also have meanings behind them, right? So, with this, what I'm saying is, if you split these up accordingly, okay, you go four, and then make a space between that one, and then you have the hey, right? So you go olive, bait, gimel, dalet, and then hey, and then going this way, you go four more, to where you got the wu, the zion, the ket, and then the ta, right? And then you got the yod. So right there, that spells Yah, right? And then down here, you have you got Shin, right? And then evenly spaced again, four characters to the Ayin, and then another four characters right from the Ayin over. So you got Yahushai spelled out, right? And I'm gonna get into the breakdown of I'm gonna show you a little bit of a breakdown on how these work.
Give us the grammatical on them too.
Come on. Okay, so each of them have a numerical value as well. All right, so 1 through 9, it'd be Aleph through Tav. These numbers 1 through 9. Then going from Yod through Samek, you got 10 to 60. And then Ayin through Sadi, 70 to 90. And then Kaf to Resh, 100 and 200. And then Shin and the Tav are 300 and 400. So basically right here, I was just taking a few notes on the breakdown of Adam. And I'm going to have to add the mem because my computer didn't save. What you have with mem is basically with the Aleph. Aleph is made of the two yods and a vav. Okay, I'm going to show y'all that. Okay, so this is the Aleph right here, number one. It's made up of this one, the yod, and one of these right here, the number at the bus side six, which is the wu or the vav. Right, and it represents the connection between the Most High and man. It's also known as like the source. So anytime you're dealing with something that's an Aleph, that has an Aleph in front of it, which it makes the A sound, this has to do with the source. All right, and it was also originally it was drawn as an ox head back in the Phoenician script. Okay, and it represents strength and a leader. Right, a dalet is actually a door, a tent door. Right. So it represents dimensions and pathways and doors. All right, the mem would be represented of water and matter. Okay, all the physical things. All right, so that's what you get when you look up Adam. Right. So what I'm going with this, with the black woman as God thing, we're gonna use the words for husband and wife, and break this down accordingly.
You can break down Kava.
So what?
You can break down Kava.
Kava? Where you get that from?
Kava.
He talking about the Kava stone?
No, Eve.
He talking about Eve?
Yeah.
Wife is Asha.
No, I'm talking about Eve. Kava.
We can break down Eve. You talking about her Hebrew name?
Yeah.
We can do that too. Okay, so the word for husband, right, is Aish. Spelled with an Aleph, a Yod, and a Shin. Okay, I'll space those apart a little more. So you can see them. Okay. So that would, let's see. There you have husband. Okay. And then the word for wife is Asha. Okay, basically starts the same way. The Aleph, Aleph, Shin, and the Hey. Okay, so when we break this down, we have the Aleph, which up here, like I was saying, it's the connection between the Most High, the connection to the source, right? And then you have a Yod. A Yod is was originally like an arm or a hand that was like working to do a deed is what it represents, right? And then you have the Shin, and the Shin originally was it like teeth or a tooth, but it can also represent fire, right?
I'll be back, guys.
Okay, come on, go ahead. So if we look at this as well, we have the Yod and the Hey in both words making up the name of the Most High, which is Yah. When we get rid of those, all right, it'll give you a little revelation of what your relationship will be like, all right? If you don't have the Most High in your relationship, all you're left with is fire. Y'all see that?
Damn.
OK. Okay, so now going further into this, all right, let's put the hay back on there. Okay, so the hay can symbolize to behold, right? Or to let me show you, like to look at something, right? Or to behold something. Okay. So you can look at this two different ways when it comes to the word wife. Let me type this in. So we have the hey, which is, well, it's actually would be spelled like that, to behold, right? And then we have the shin, which is the fire, right? And then we have the olive, which is the source, or the man, right? Or the connection between the man and the Most High. So we could look at it as, behold the fire of man. Right? So that means that our women, you know what I mean, add that spark in our life to complete us. Right? Now if we look at it slightly differently, right? We have hey, which means to behold. Everything has negative and positive forces, right? So we have shin, which can mean to destroy as well. And we have olive, which is man. So then we get behold, the destroyer of man, which is what we see in the Garden of Eden, with Eve being the first Eve from the fruit. You following me on this, Art?
Come.
Okay, hold on.
I'm tracking.
Let's get the name of Eve. And look it up in Hebrew, and we'll break it down like that. Kavah. That's what you were saying. Now, the way that the Hebrew is also the way it's written, right? It's written in a way that we would have spoke, you know what I'm saying? Sounds that are easy for us to make. So like the white man, you know what I'm saying? He's got those skinny lips, so he put in the B, you know what I'm saying? Whereas we would have pronounced it Kawu, Kawa. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
So that's a Ket, a Wa, and a He. Now we're gonna break that down. Okay, so with the ket you have is a ket is symbolic of a tent wall.
A border, a wall, a defenses.
Kind of, yeah, like the kind of like a border, you know what I'm saying?
Uh-huh.
A hedge of protection. Okay, the wah is actually like a the wu is actually was originally a male, right? But it also represents the center of the universe, basically. All right, so it represents the center. Okay, and then you have the he, which I was just read earlier, means to behold. Okay, I'm gonna look up. I'm gonna show y'all some more in-depth definitions of these letters as well. See if you can't find a better understanding.
So it's protecting the center. Behold, I protect the center. What does the center do?
Well, the wa is like a connection. So it represents, like I said, the center of the universe, or like that medium.
Oh, okay,
to pass between.
So basically, it's behold, I protect.
behold and protect it.
Okay, so we have the ancient script. It's the ket, right? It's the tent wall, the fence, separation outside, inside, have, and divide. You have the wall, which is a nail or a tent peg, added a hook to secure. Alright, these are the original scripts and how they were written and what they were portraying. And then we have the hay, which means look, behold, reveal, the breath, and man.
Let's
see.
We say you can say man protects my center, which would the center would be heaven. Would be heaven is how would you break it?
That's what I'm trying to figure out. Oh yeah, I forgot about this. It also can mean life, cause like the het, it can also mean life, which l'chaim means to life. The la as the lamed in that sentence meaning to, and then but this says the het or chai is the traditional symbol of life, and ironically of sin. It is also the sign of transcendence and of divine grace, pointing to the possibility that a human being can transcend the limitations of physical existence. The Wa traditionally symbolizes humanity and the restoration of judgment. As the third letter in the Ha, Shem, the holy name, Wa represents completion, redemption, and transformation. It is the letter of continuity, uniting heaven with earth.
Okay, so you could say, man protects my heaven, which is immortality. Man protects my immortality.
Right, right.
My house is my immortality.
Yeah.
Because the bet is the same thing as the het in Medunetcher, and the het is a house in Medunetcher, and the symbol is the same.
Khan, yeah, that's absolutely true too. I seen the brother Isu Sifa, he actually posted a video with Polite talking about mentioning the ancient Hebrew and how the het was actually originally, or the hay was actually originally het. Let's see, the hay, the spirit of the Lord, it symbolizes divinity and gentility. This letter appears twice in the full name of the Most High, together with Yod, forms the divine name Yah, according to tradition. The world to come was created through utterance of the letter Yod. This word was created through the sound of hay, which is pronounced as a mere exhalation of breath, requiring little movement from tongue or lip. So this is just a few of the things I was going through. And then, let's see, let's get up Proverbs, since we were talking about the word high. I don't know how I forgot that. We go to Proverbs 31:10. This is another scripture she brought up last night. It says, who can find a virtuous woman, for her price is far above rubies? So while we were talking last night, I got to looking at this, and the word virtuous is chayil, right? So let me break that down. You got a het, a lamet, a yod, and a lamet, right? So it'd be like this. You got your het, your yod, and your lamet. Right. And as we were just talking about, the het means, or the hi, right? The het and the yod mean life together, right? It's life. Yes, the yod, the arm showing that something is working towards that goal, right? And then you have the lamet, which is a staff, shepherd's staff. Alright, so when you see the shepherd's staff, you are walking to something, or you're being led by something. So, to be virtuous would mean that you are walking towards the goal of life.
Immortality.
Come.
Man. And okay, now what letters are those? Working towards the goal of immortality?
These right here. I'm gonna put them out next to each other so you can see them better.
What word is that?
Hayal.
And what's the English word?
Virtuous.
Virtuous. Wow. Virtuous means striving to be immortal.
God. Yeah, hit. Yo.
There's nobody that can disagree with the word virtue.
Hold on. See what I'm saying? According to the
But is that the word virtuous? That, I mean, that this definition is only in regards to the Hebrew word of virtue, right? Or is that in general?
Well, we were. I'm glad you actually showed. Did you? Because I got that idea last night when we were talking on your show. But this is what I'm showing him here is the definitions, the breakdowns according to the Hebrew math.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, basically, with the Hebrew and with the Bible, we have pictographic representations in order for our ancestors to convey the messages that they were trying to get across to us. We can kind of look deeper in and see what points they were trying to tell, is what I'm trying to show here. But I'm actually just learning it myself. So we got a brother that got on here a few nights ago and kind of broke it down. I had seen the different the pictographic representations from, you know, the ancient Phoenician scripts, but I hadn't really put two and two together. Although I do read in the Hebrew now, kind of a better way to look at it. Did you catch that breakdown though?
Yes.
No. Look good.
I mean, the last half of it, I got the gist that the, what is it, Lamed?
Lamed.
Which means virtue, I guess? Virtuous?
Let me go back.
Kayil is virtue.
Oh.
Yeah, the whole word right here, hold on, let me see, make sure you can see it. So the word for virtuous is Kayal, spelled with a het, which is this one right here.
The Kayal.
Next to it. And then you got a yod, and then a lamed. Uh-huh. So when you break down each of these, right, now a het is representative of life. Because if you break the root word down, it's hi, which is just the het and the yod put together. And that means life. And the het is representative of a tent wall, or a tent being put up. So the yod was originally drawn as an arm.
Mm-hmm.
And the arm shows that it's working or doing a deed. Okay, and then the lamet is a shepherd's staff.
Mm-hmm.
So the shepherd staff is either guiding you or you're walking towards something. Okay, and we see that as well with the word al, or what people say is el.
Yeah.
Right? The source leading. Okay, so you have the aleph.
Actually pronounced al.
Yeah, the aleph represents the source to the Most High, or the connection between man and the Most High. Right? And then you have the Lamed, again, which is the staff that is leading us, staff of the shepherd. You see this in Alahaim. In other words, let me see. Let's actually let's do this. Got any other ones out on your mind we can break down?
Me, no. Oh, I see Israel changed his profile picture. Got too much crap for that, didn't you? I told you.
I'm over here. I'm happy about that, though. You know, a righteous man loves correction. You know what I'm saying? So you can't mix business with pleasure. We sit here all day having a good time doing our father's work, right? You know, just doing little basic stuff every day. And then, but I got my whole business on the YouTube, which is ridiculous. You know what I'm saying? You're not supposed to mix the business with pleasure.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because I know someone that, because, okay, so he accidentally sent an email from his pro-black page to his employer, and then I guess later on his employer went, she sent an email to him in response, like months later. And she had checked out his pro-black page and saw all this stuff on it. And in her white supremacist mind, thought of it as racist until he got fired.
That's crazy. These girls told me what happened to me. These couple of black girls I was working with.
Man. They told me that what happened. What kind of system we're living in? they control our finances by calling you racist. That's why you don't speak publicly about your knowledge. You don't never speak publicly about your knowledge, especially at work.
I wanted to break this one down as well, just to see if maybe we can figure something out about it, get some understanding on it. This is this word has been at the heat of argument and discussion. Hold on. There it goes. Okay.
After that, we can do rock, yeah.
That's what I'm doing, actually.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. That was some good intuition on that one. I guess I rang a bell when I said it's been bringing a lot of discussion.
Yeah, I see that racial. It looks like an R, so I'm thinking rock. Thinking rock here. So.
I'm going to have to go back and look some of these up so I have them all memorized. Let's see. My mouse wants to work. Let's see.
Let's stay right there. So you're watching Claim Your Heritage. Where else are you gonna get is the Hebrew broken down like this, other than Hebrew Math Channel? We're gonna break it down for you.
How could you going in?
Okay, let's get the man a cough right quick. Koof, my bad. It's koof. There are numerous traditional meanings for this letter, including to buy the cell, eye of the needle, ape or monkey. Esoterically, it is the sign of holiness, both human and divine, and the symbol of abstinence and control. Koof also represents the various growth cycles of our world. So I guess we can we just put divine in there. We also know that the word Kodash comes from that as well.
You must have learned how to type a target, huh?
So what?
You learn how to type a target.
I had to take typing classes in the second grade, man.
Years.
This is a Rush. It says, literally head, chief king, or supreme one. Paradoxically, Rush can also be taken to mean to become impoverished. It stands for the challenge of the choice greatness or degradation, between which elements there is a very fine dividing line. Rush also represents the fact that the wicked retain the potential to repent at any chosen moment.
They spelled degradation wrong. It's
yeah. Yeah, I know, it messed me up a little bit too.
Supposed to be degradation.
Let's see. The iron, this means eye, wellspring, source, or center, and is linked with the Egyptian eye of Horus. Iron is therefore the symbol of perception and insight of the physical eye and of the spiritual eye. It illustrates symbolically that the human eye can be taken as a microcosm of the universe.
Okay. Okay, see? See how that relates to flat Earth?
Come.
So recently here, everybody's been comparing flat Earth to an eye. And then you got the, what's that southern continent called? The snow continent?
Come on, Antarctica.
Antarctica, right? That surrounds flat Earth, right?
Right.
Most people who study this call it endless or forever or whatever, you know what I'm saying? But that's what I be saying, that we're on top of a sphere. And we're in the iris of the eye, and the North Pole is the part where the light goes into the eye, you know what I'm saying?
Kind. And the word also is kind of weird, because people say pronounce it Rakia, you know what I mean? But I prefer to say Rakiyat, because that iron was originally pronounced as an I. But we also have the Yod, which is literally hand and symbol of the Jew. It also means monument or share. Although the smallest letter in the Hebrew alphabet, Yod contains as much meaning as the rest of the Hebrew alphabet combined. Yod signifies creation itself and all the metaphysical processes, and on its own stands as an important symbol for the Creator.
Wow.
So that's basically what we get when we break down Rocky Guy. And for those listening in, the translation of that would be the firmament. And what we've been kind of having discussion about is, what exactly is the firmament, right?
Uh-huh. I was hoping the word itself would define a firmness, a hardness, or a shape.
Yeah, that's why we need a brother like Isu to get on here and kind of break it down, because he can go into it a little more in depth, as well as showing what's called the 720. You know what I mean? Like, he knows what the words mean when you spell them backwards as well.
So yeah, he does. Yeah, 720 on.
Kind. And they also have they also each have a geometric value as well, which I've been having a hard time kind of finding the information just by researching. So hopefully we can get a hold of that brother and get some more insight to this thing. Because, I mean, I've been personally reading in Hebrew for about maybe a year now.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, like I said, this is a kind of a new concept. It's not new to the Jewish people. The difference is we're supposed to use the geometry, and they use numerology. You feel what I'm saying?
The geometry of what? The letter?
Kind. They all represent different
degrees. Which form of the letter?
What do you mean?
When you say geometry, that's a shape. So,
well, like, you got degrees, and degrees make up shapes.
Uh-huh.
Right? So let me show you something. Okay, I'm gonna show you this first, right? So when you have the Aleph, it makes the number one, right? The Aleph is equal to the numerical value of one. And the Wa is numerical value of 6, okay, and the Yod is 10. So the Aleph is made up of two yods and one vav, or wav. So that would give it, if you break it down like that, each one, it give you a value of 26. Right? You got 10 plus 10 on top and bottom, and you got 6 in the middle. So you got 26. Now also, you spell the Most High's name. Right? And now remember that the Aleph is the center. Right? And it's the source. The source of creation. Right? So you got a yo, which is equal to 10. You have a hey, which is equal to 5. A wa, which is equal to 6. And then another hey, which is equal to 5. And we have 10 plus 5 plus 6 plus 5.
31. 26.
You see that?
Yeah. Uh-huh.
The same thing goes with the olive. That says made of two yolks and a bob. Equal to 10 plus 10 plus 6. You see how I did that?
Yeah.
That's the numerology that they use in Kabbalah, things of that nature. But show you a quick one of what the brother was showing in his video.
Mm-hmm.
He was talking about.
So that's just another tool that they're using against us, basically.
Right, right. So if you look at Yahusha, right, when you spell it out, the Y or the Yod is equal to 288 degrees, and the Hey is equal to 72 degrees. Add it up, you get 360 when you spell Yah.
Numerology equals degrees, which equals geometry.
Okay. Actually, I don't even know how Buddy even on the show to get on our show.
Who?
Itsu.
Oh, yeah, no. I when I shared it, some guy shared it in their group. And Itsu Shatifa picked it up and said, hey, that sounds interesting. Let me take a look at it.
And why aren't we supposed to use numerology?
That's a question I'm going to have to do some more research on. Honestly, sis.
What is that about? What do you mean we're not supposed to use
it? The way the brother was explaining it, all the words were written according to sacred geometry. So, like, numerology is dealing with additional numbers. You know what I'm saying?
Who told us not to use it?
Say again?
Who told us not to use numerology?
What do you mean? Who told us not to use it? I mean, you can use it if you want to use it. It's just not the original way. Because all the, according to what the lesson the brother gave, it all comes back to degrees. It's all basically in circles in different degrees.
Okay. Or in closed systems.
Okay.
Because a square would be also 360 degrees. And a triangle is 360 degrees. Okay, I got it. No, a triangle is 180 degrees. So I
yeah, got 60, 60, 60. It's 180.
Yeah. I'll be black in just a second.
Fine. Hey, sis, you have any other questions? I'm sorry, you got any questions?
No, I don't have any questions.
appreciate y'all coming on. We didn't have too many topics tonight, really. He made an app for the elections and whatnot for people that want to vote and join the Hebrew Israelite nation.
Vote for what?
For a leader to lead this nation. We got to go back to Hosea 1:11. Hey, let's get there. What do you think of that, actually? What are your thoughts on that?
I don't know.
Like, what's the first thing that comes to mind when we talk about building a nation, when we're talking about electing a leader?
My first thing is, how are we going to do it without notifying the pink people? As I like to call them. Pink people.
I mean, we're doing it right now by constantly networking and trying to build. We just don't have anybody that technically subscribes to the same idea, either or that. Or you have people that are in sync with the same idea, they just don't want to get in sync with other brothers and sisters. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
They have their own thing going and their own agendas, where people like us are just, you know, like me personally, I'm just looking for a better way to protect my family. You see what I'm saying?
Definitely. Like today, I wasn't there to see it, thankfully, but there was some sort of madness between, I think Azar was in on it with Lotus, and then there was this other thing between the Seer and Waterman. I don't know what's going on.
Hey, Asar, I was on with y'all this morning. You had some good business tips and business ideas. What are your thoughts on building this nation? Because I know when we were talking about, I don't even know. Hey, brother, you there? I don't know if he's there or not, but earlier this morning we were talking about basically starting our businesses and exchanging business with other black business owners. And I think that's the main important thing that we haven't done, like, and it's something that we're all guilty of in the black community.
Recently, yeah.
I know a lot of times.
Used to do that before integration. Black people used to only support black businesses, and so they were elevating. And then, you know, a covert operation, which they, you know, generally more advanced than us in the understanding of how economics is what builds everything. So they sent in people to say, oh, well, y'all need to integrate with the white community, and then that decimated the black economy. So, you know, with us, when it comes to building a black economy, we are 100% behind that. And it's very easy to do, but it's very, very, very hard to accept, because everybody is integrated with the current economy, and they think that it's going to last forever.
Well, it's also hard because there are black businesses, but a lot of them are online, and then you have to pay for shipping and handling, which is expensive. And the main thing that we spend, or at least that in my house, because we're trying to stay as healthy as possible, we sacrifice our other funds to keep healthy, because out here food is expensive. So there are no black-owned grocery stores that I know of in California.
At all.
Uh-uh.
Actually, you know what's crazy, though? I asked people this question down here in Tennessee. And actually, just recently, this changed. I'll tell you how. But I'll ask people, like, hey, you ever seen any black people working at the gas stations around here?
And I mean, there's a gas station on every corner. And there's not a single, like, you know, Negro working in one. You got the Hamites, you know, the Ethiopian Hamites, Kushites that own their gas stations. You know what I'm saying? But other than that, there's not a single Negro working in any of the gas stations out here. Now, why I said that just changed because actually this girl I know started working at the Shell station down the street. But other than that, you don't see any, like, you know, aside from black-owned businesses, you don't even hardly see no black employees.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, recently here.
We have to...
Well, the ones that are owned by the Indians and all, and the Asians and all that, they hire their own usually, so.
Most definitely. That's what the Ethiopians do. And they act like they're like, you know, when they see a black guy over here.
Every other bloodline hires their own people. White people hire their own people.
Yeah.
Indian people hire only Indians, but all the motels they own. The Chinese, the Asians hire only Asians for the nail shops and beauty worlds that they own.
Oh, okay. So there's an article in The Root of a man who owns a mini empire of gas stations on the East Coast.
Right.
His name is Ayob Joy Mamo.
Exactly.
He's
from Yemen, right?
He owned a company in Addis Ababa, which is in Ethiopia, and now he owns one in the east, along out in the East Coast, and they're a multi-million-dollar company, I guess. I'm gonna have to read this later.
Hey, yeah, we got a Kushite down here named Tap, and he owns a store called the Blue Store. It's like a little you know, you go get your beer, whatever. Cigars, pillows, and things of that nature. And, you know, you got chips and stuff like that. And you got a dude in there to be cooking food. And he also used to have a club, a couple clubs, actually, out here. But, and he's mostly doing just gas stations now. But, you know, they get like, I want to say he said he got like a $50,000 grant when he moved from Ethiopia to the States. So, you know, they're basically like shoveling money out of their pockets to give these immigrants as well, for them to be able to start businesses and kind of make a come up.
Okay, so there's one in L.A., in Compton, Cooper Shell, and there's one in Detroit, Michigan, Davis Brothers 7 in Outer.
Shalom, brothers. Peace. I want to ask you a question. I see you said Kushite and Hamites. You know, I'm kind of still, you know, new to all these terms and things of that nature. What do you mean by that?
I'm going to show you. I'm going to put it on the screen for you. And basically what we were talking about, I was trying to get a SAR on here, but, you know, we were talking this morning about black businesses. And one of the key things the brother pointed out was that we have to network in business strictly with each other. You know what I'm saying? So that's kind of what I was bringing out just now when it comes to black businesses. Okay, let's see. Let me screen share it quick. Okay, you can see my screen? King.
Yeah, now it's presented. Yeah, you good now.
Okay, so... When we use the term Ham or Hamite, it's because he was Ham was the youngest son of Noah, right? And then his sons were Cush, Mizraim, Put, and Canaan. So these are all the African tribes and nations. Now these started out as just nations, and then they ended up as sub tribes. So if you look at let's go back. If you look at Canaan. We had the Canaanites were made up of the Hivites, the Jebusites, the Girgashites, the Perizzites, you know what I'm saying, and so on and so forth. When I say Cush is Ethiopia. So when I refer to like an Ethiopian person, I'll say a Cushite or a Cushy. Mizraim became the father of all the Egyptians, right? And then Put is Libya. And then
okay, I can dig it.
Khan. And then of course, like in the Zondervan Bible Dictionary, when you look up Ham, it clearly states Ham, the youngest son of Noah, born probably about 96 years before the flood. He became the progenitor of the dark races, not the Negroes. You know, and that's in a white man's book that's making a clear distinction between us and the African Hamites.
Okay, so would a Hamite be considered like somebody that y'all don't mess with or something, or
they would be the people from that are originally from the continent. You know what I'm saying? Where we do have those of us that are still over there. There's a distinction in bloodline.
After the flood, the son Ham with his few children and wife moved into the African area, right? And they repopulated that continent. So Ham made a mental error that was punished and passed on and encoded in his DNA and passed on to all his descendants.
This is also something we got to remember too. Let me show you this. This has to do with the African Hamites. We got to remember that we were sold into slavery by Africans. So when I talk about my brothers and my people, I'm talking about strictly Israel. You see what I'm saying? And I think that's what I was saying earlier. Like everybody, like that was sold into slavery and sold into captivity, that's Israel. Okay, so this is the Most High talking to Tyre and Zidon, right, which are two Canaanite nations. In Joel 3 and 4, he says, "Yeah, and what have ye to do with me, O Tyre and Zidon, and all the coast of Palestine? Will ye render me a recompense? And if ye recompense me swiftly and speedily, will I return your recompense upon your own head?" So when he's talking to this nation right here, the Tyre and Zidon in the coast of Palestine. He's talking to the African peoples that were living there at the time. It was all inhabited by the Canaanites. Okay, and he says, "Because ye have taken my silver and my gold and have carried into your temples my goodly pleasant things." So they spoiled the Most High's temple. Alright, he says, "The children also of Judah," okay, aka the Negroes, "and the children of Jerusalem, Northern Kingdom, have ye sold unto the Grecians, that ye might remove them far from their border." All right, so they sold us away to where we wouldn't be in our own land anymore. "Behold, I will raise them out of the place where ye have sold them, and will return recompense upon your own head. And I will sell your sons and your daughters into the hand of the children of Judah, and they shall sell them to the Sabians, to a people far off, for the Lord has spoken it." Okay. So we got.
But when I read that, bro, you know how I take it. And this is my personal. I take that as that's just the Arabs and the white Jews that's over there that just took our place. I don't really feel like it was Africans.
But you gotta remember though, like I said, that the Africans, and see right here in this scripture itself, they had already committed this act, and then when we learn about Africans selling us into slavery. From the west coast of Africa as well. You know where I'm coming from? Because the Africans and the Arabs sold us into the hand of the white men. They were doing most of the work.
No comment, bro. No comment.
But that doesn't mean to say that, like, okay, like how you got Israelites that are strictly against Africa, like, you know,
right,
against the continent, you know what I'm saying, or the landmass, you know what I'm saying, but we're waiting on recompense from what happened to our people.
So the descendants of those should still be blamed?
Yeah, let me get let's go to Isaiah 14 and 21.
You ever heard of probate court?
Probation court or probate?
Probate.
I've heard of probate, but I don't know what it means.
Probate is when a person dies and their inheritance is passed on to their children. Okay? So that same inheritance passed on to the children includes debt. So if a person dies and owes people or a company or whatever a debt, then that debt is inherited by the children. So
we have go ahead.
Yeah, that's what happens whenever you see are their children responsible for their parents' debt. Probate court says yes.
Okay, Isaiah 14:21 states, he has slaughter for his children for the iniquity of their fathers, that they do not rise, nor possess the land, nor fill the face of the world with cities. Okay, and then we're going to, we're basically saying that the children have to suffer for what the fathers have done. Let's go to the law, the Torah, okay?
I'll pull up probate while you pull up the scripture.
Come, let's go to Exodus 25. He states, thou shalt not bow down thyself to them, nor serve them, for I, the Most High, am a jealous Elohim, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children unto the third and fourth generation of them that hate me. Then you see again that the children are being punished for the father's deeds. Now, we read a scripture yesterday that said that wouldn't happen anymore, but that's in the very, very latter days, because everybody's kind of going to be responsible for their own actions, because once that last generation comes, that's going to be it. So in Exodus 21:16, we have another law, right? It states, and he that stealeth a man and selleth him, right? So you steal a man and sell him in slavery, but if he be found in his hand, he shall surely be put to death. So the punishment, the penalty for stealing a man is death. The punishment for selling that man is death. And if you get found with that man, just like how we're still here in America, people that have been stolen, right? The punishment for that under the law of death.
Okay, I got a probate definition ready to go.
So it does that mean, like, even for, like, I heard you say you mentioned the West Africans, and right now I know at least in Ghana they have been the ones to ask for forgiveness. And then say that we have free reign to come back over there. So, I mean, wouldn't that be like them repenting?
And actually, Ghana was started by us. So, I can only imagine that some of the people that came up with that were our people. You know what I'm saying? Like, right. I'm sure you know Ghana was a large empire at one point in time in West Africa.
Yeah.
Yeah, so, actually, I got a buddy that stays over there. But yeah, that's interesting. I haven't heard that they said we can come back over there.
Yeah, you can go to the website. I think it's Ghana.org, or you know how it goes.
Yeah, but, Ghana and Zimbabwe.
Yeah, they let we can come right back, and we don't gotta pay no. You know how some people gotta pay for citizenship and all that.
God.
No, not us. It's an open gate. We just gotta get there.
We got brothers and sisters in Nigeria. I'm gonna have to look it up to get the actual name of the they're trying to basically secede from Nigeria and start their own nation. But they're kind of
the
mad.
The Igbo,
yeah, the Igbo are part of this movement. I forget the name of the actual the landmass that they were trying
Igbo
to
Igbo land. Also known as the Biafra.
Let me see. But like they were kind of mad because there hasn't been like an Igbo president in Nigeria.
No.
I know it's by design because mm-hmm. you know they say that Obama is a Negro, but we know he's not, and we know for a fact that they would never put one of us in that office.
That's correct. That's correct.
They'll never let an evil president because evil has oil, and they don't want an evil president having control of their own oil.
Okay, so probate is the legal process whereby a will is proved in a court and accepted as a valid public document that is the true last testament of the deceased. The granting of probate is the first step in the legal process of administering the estate of a deceased person, resolving all claims and distributing the deceased person's property under a will. A probate court decides the legal validity of a testator's will and grants its approval, also known as granting probate to the executor. The probated will then becomes a legal instrument that may be enforced by the executor in the law courts if necessary. A probate also officially appoints the executor, generally named in the will, as having legal power to dispose the testator's assets in the manner specified in the testator's will. However, through the probate process, a will may be contested. So just as the person's assets can be contributed to the children, also the liabilities of a deceased person will be transferred to the children. So in our understanding, these people have a debt that they realize that is a debt. So probate, if you can prove to intelligent people that they have this debt, a liability, then that must be addressed and redressed.
Now, excuse me, I got the little man over here. But I'm sure in the Torah or the Bible, there's a certain type of slavery that we practice that beast, that we didn't know that beast practiced. Like, you know, we probably had slaves, but they can marry into our family later on once they pay their debt. So,
it's yeah, like, but that was more of an indentured servitude. It wasn't slavery as we know it today.
They went through, they got to the chance to go free every sabbatical year. So every seventh year, you basically wipe everybody's debts, so they would get to go free. Now, if they had married a wife and had children, then they could stay, but they would be basically like a servant for life. But that's in the case of if they, you know, of course they would have to love their master to want to do that. But it wasn't the white man basically went above and beyond. If you read in the law, the scriptures. There's a law that states that you're not supposed to leave a man's body hanging overnight. So I'm saying we've seen how they did a boy in 12 years a slave, leaving there for like 3 days.
All right. Interesting. You know.
I mean, as you just read Amaziah, if you steal a man and sell him, that should be put to death. That alone totally nixes any excuse that white people made for the slavery of our ancestors.
Okay. So that debt of they must be put to death was not executed when they were alive, and it is inherited by their children.
You also have you have special rules for slaves of our own brethren or servants, right? So Leviticus 25 and 39 states, and if thy brother that dwelleth by thee be waxen poor, and be sold under thee. Right? So if he has like a debt that he has to pay off through his servitude, right? Thou shalt not compel him to serve as a bondservant, but as an hired servant, and as a sojourner, he shall be with thee, and shall serve thee until the year of Jubal, which is the seventh year. And it says, and then shall he depart from thee, both he and his children with him, and shall return unto his own family, and unto the possession of his father shall he return. For they are my servants, which I brought forth out of the land of Egypt. Remember, the Egypt is the house of bondage, right? It says they shall not be sold as bondmen. So you weren't allowed to sell another Hebrew man into bondage.
Mm-hmm. And there was a woman, I don't remember her name. I read about her in African American history class. And she had read her Bible, and she was able to, by using the Bible, legally get herself set free. So I guess white people caught on to this, and they made sure that nobody else could discern what the texts were saying.
God. And then also,
I don't remember her name.
King, I want to point out too that the Bible uses the word bondmen and bondmaids when it comes to we talk about slaves. So if you read on in Leviticus 25 and 43, it says, thou shalt, and it's talking about still in reference to the Hebrew man as a servant, right? It says, thou shalt not rule over him with rigor, but shalt fear thy Elohim. And it goes on to say, both thy bondmen and thy bondmaids, which thou shalt have, shall be of the heathen that are round about you. Of them shall ye buy bondmen and bondmaids. Moreover, of the children of the strangers that do sojourn among you, of them shall ye buy, and of their families that are with you, which they begat in your land, and they shall be your possession. And so this is another thing that's also going to happen when we come back into the kingdom. We're going to have these heathen as our possessions to serve us.
I don't know, that just sounds like the same thing. It's like, to me, it sounds like it's like perpetuate. I mean, you know, you definitely know how I feel. You know, we already seen how on the Black Star panel, and I want to give a shout out to Israel for making that beast, you know, go ahead and bow down to Zion. You know what I'm saying? But at the same time, I'm just looking, you know, just trying to step outside the box and just look at it like I'm an alien. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
It's like, you know, it's like definitely not throwing no life rafts, but it's like, you know what I'm saying? It's like
it's a cycle.
It's like we're doing the same thing to them that they did to us. But our law tells us to treat them very well, whereas they don't
have a law. Right.
They don't have a law.
Yeah, actually, there's a law that says you're supposed to treat them better than you would yourself, and if they don't have their own bed, you're supposed to give them yours or something like that.
Right. Okay.
That certainly never happened to our people.
Yeah. So they, you know, they treated us very terribly, but once they are with it. Once they are subdued and they're like, okay, we understand that you have to rule in order for Earth to be balanced and Earth to be healthy and for us to have a place to live over the next 1,000 years, 2,000, 3,000, 4,000 years. Because the way it's being run now, we won't have a place to live in 200, 300 years.
Right.
Because
right.
of how they're polluting everything.
Con.
So once we get in power, we're going to reverse the damage they've done, and then we're going to treat them way, way better than they treated us in slavery. So there's no reason to feel type of pity for them, because the same way that we have to work now to pay for water and pay for things that are free, like water, then they're going to be doing the same thing. But it's not going to be like how they subjected us to slavery, which is chains and shackles and ankle shackles and wrist chains.
Hey, no. They're going to have the chains when we take them over there. They gonna have to change. It's in the scripture.
No, these are. He's talking about the people that.
Who's feeling pity? I don't feel pity.
He's talking about the people that are resisting our leadership. Mm-hmm. So they're gonna be very afraid that we're going to abuse them like they abused us. So they're gonna resist as highly as possible, as strongly as they possibly can. But the ones that realize that, okay, yeah, I will work for the kingdom, just like we are all working for a ruler right now. So, you know, I often say, I got my feet kicked up right now. I'm chilling.
Right. I've already had some of them fools up on my page giving me mess, talking about, well, if you are in our position, you do the same thing to us. Blah, blah, blah.
So even though I'm a slave right now, as we speak, I'm still comfortable.
Chilling.
That's right. How they're going to feel.
Time. Except they're going to, you know, it's going to be kind of service, right, but it's going to be rest. I want to break this down to you for King. Let me see. Hey, hold on, y'all. Hey, and are y'all going to be on here for a while, man? Because I got to pick up my uncle from work here in a minute. And
You know it's 24/7 with me, bro.
Huh?
You know it's 24/7 with me, bro.
Con. Yeah, I want to make sure.
Oh, y'all really? Be
on too.
Did he call you?
Huh?
Did he call you?
Yeah, he's call. Well, he's calling downstairs. I ain't answer the phone or nothing. But I can hear it ringing. I want to break this down right quick for the brother. It's hold on a sec. Okay, y'all can see my screen and all that.
Yeah.
Okay, it says this is Deuteronomy 28:48. Therefore, shalt thou serve thine enemies. Hold on, what is it, babe? Chung got the phone. Okay. Thank you, Kai. Okay, so Deuteronomy 28:48 says, therefore shalt thou serve thine enemies, which the Most High shall send against thee, in hunger, and in thirst, and in nakedness, and in want of all things. And he shall put a yoke of iron upon thy neck until he have destroyed thee. So, like the Bible was saying, we have to go to the devil for food, clothing, and water, which we shouldn't even need. And it says, the Lord shall bring a nation against thee from far, from the end of the earth, as swift as the eagle flieth, a nation whose tongue thou shalt not understand. A nation of fierce countenance, which shall not regard the person of old, nor shall favor to the young. So it's telling you that, like how he was saying, they don't got no laws. They didn't care how they treated us or what they did to us. You know what I'm saying?
That's right. You watching Claim Your Inheritance, the World Holiest Government. Amaziah Howard broke down the Hebrew for you very clear. If you're not a master of Hebrew by now, then you need to watch a few more programs. I am the President Pro Tem. That means the temporary president of New Jerusalem until the real president wins election. I am the governor, the acting governor of North Carolina for Brim Nation. Every gram under the sound of my voice needs to come back to the law, statutes, and commandments. It's easy to learn. You need to accept Hamashiach, who you call Jesus Christ, as your teacher, and I'll be happy to speak for him. I'll give it to my co-host to close it out. Okay. So he says, all praises to Yahweh, Baha Shem, Yahweh Shai, and Shalom.